By what name are you known?
There are some who call me... Tim?
Welcome to another episode of Timmy Talks, the channel where we talk old school magic. And today we are back at the Reprint Masters, the tournament that celebrates the reprint sets, 4th edition, Chronicles, and Revised. And we are going to look at a top 16 match played in this online tournament between Tim and Roman. Tim is playing a red-green aggro deck that he's called Arabian Atog. And Roman is playing a Dead Guy Ale, so white and black deck with Sengir Vampires and Serra Angels. Now, before I start with the deck, I would first like to point out that, as always, you can also choose to go to the games first. I know that some of you prefer to do that. The easiest way to do that is by checking out the description below, because there you will find several timestamps. One of those timestamps reads MTG Games. Click on there and that'll take you straight to the games. And in the description below, you can also find more information about the specific rule set and a link to the tournament website. So if you like this kind of magic, check out the description and check out the tournament website. There's tons of information on there. And for now, we are going to start with the deck techs. I'm going to start with the deck of Tim, Arabian Atog. Let's have a look. And here we see the deck of Tim, Arabian Atog. And it's pretty interesting because I know I talked about this deck being primarily red and green. There's actually also a blue component in the deck, and that is a full playset of Serendib Efreets. They're also included in here. And there are also two black cards, the Demonic Tutor and the Mind Twist. So it's interesting to see a deck that, you know, plays four colors, doesn't play with Birds of Paradise, for example, or Llanowar Elves to ramp up. Instead, I think Tim has chosen to just go for a very healthy mana curve that he's got in this deck. If you look at his one drops, he's got eight options for the one drop, four black Vises, four Kird Apes, and I'm not even including the Lightning Bolts. And then he also has eight two drops in the form of three Ankh of Mishras, two Argovian Pixies, two Atogs, and a Sylvan Library. So he's got a lot of options there on the second position as well. And then on the three drop, he's got, of course, that playset of Serendib Efreet. So those are his only blue cards in the deck. And then later on, his end curve is the Erhnam Djinn, right? The 4/5 for 4 mana. So that's really what he's kind of going for, this natural kind of build-up. And he does have a little bit of mana ramp going on in his deck. He's playing with 2 mana vaults and a Soul Ring. Now, when I'm looking at this deck, of course, when he gets that mana vault early in the game, he can use it to deploy an early Erhnam, of course. But I think his main idea probably is to use those mana vaults for maybe a big Fireball to kind of finish the game off, you know? Direct damage, and that is why I always think that red-green aggro is so strong. Direct damage is so good in an aggro build because, you know, you've got your early creature frets going on. They probably will be able to deal like 8, 9, maybe 10 points of damage. And then you can finish it off with your bolts and your fireball and you just win the game, right? So you don't have that pressure that when, for example, you play a mono-green deck or a mono-blue deck, oftentimes, even though there's some space for direct damage in those decks, but less so than when you play with red, obviously. In those decks, it's obviously a race where you got to play out as many creatures as you can early on because you want to kill your opponent mainly with creature combat damage. And whereas when you look at this deck, you know, you've got the Vise, you've got the direct damage, you've got the Ankh of Mishra, and then of course you've got that whole creature plan. So your creatures are just part of the puzzle. You know, the puzzle is bigger than that. And I think that makes this a really strong deck. Now, it's going to be interesting because he's taking on a deck that's playing with, for example, Lantex, a deck that doesn't necessarily need a lot of mana. It's also playing with Rituals. So it's going to be interesting to see, you know, how the Ankh strategy and the Vise strategy is going to work against the deck of Roman. Talking about that, let's take a look at his deck, Angels and Vampires. And here we see the deck of Roman. So I've called it Angels and Vampires for the simple reason that there are two Sengir Vampires in here and two Serra Angels. But of course, the deck is more than just that. We see the very strong, you know, the white removal here with four swords to Plowshares. We also have two Disenchants, two Divine Offerings. And then we see an interesting Lantex Armageddon pack in this deck as well. Of course, Lantex and Armageddon works together quite well. Lantex, the enchantment that lets you draw up to, or actually take out, three basic land cards out of your library during your upkeep if you control less lands than your opponent. And of course, Armageddon, the sorcery that destroys all lands in play. So the idea here is simple, right? You get your Lantex out, you play your Armageddon, destroy all the lands, and simply sit back and wait for your opponent to play out that first land, and then ka-ching, you can start getting out those basics out of your deck with your land tech. So that's huge value. And what I like here is that I think land techs and Armageddon and actually Dark Ritual work together quite well, because with Dark Ritual, you only need that one scrub land or that swamp to kind of get three mana up and going. And with that three mana, you can start casting your Hypnotic Specter, I guess preferably your Hippie, right? But if you have some extra mana, you can kind of ramp up into like a Sengir Vampire. Maybe, you know, if you've got two planes and a black, you can start playing your Serra Angel. So the Dark Ritual allows you to play out your bigger spells, your bigger creatures, without the need of all the mana. And so you can still kind of keep your land techs active, right? You still have that pressure on your opponent where you kind of have this land tech stare down where your opponent doesn't want to play a land because, you know, they don't want to activate the text for you. But if they don't play a land, you know, you just played a big creature with the help of your Dark Ritual, you know, they're behind, they're going to lose life. They cannot keep that up forever. So you're going to make it difficult for them. Now, I do think in this particular matchup, it's going to be difficult for Roman, because we just saw Tim's deck, and Tim, his deck doesn't need a lot of mana. As a matter of fact, he's the player playing with Ankh of Mishras, so he doesn't plan on playing out a lot of lands. He's playing with a black Vise, so he's like, okay, if you have a land tech out and you're waiting for me to play out lands, I will simply play out my black Vise and make you bleed for it, you know? And land techs and Vise can also kind of, it can backfire on you. You've got a nice full hand because you got an active text. And then maybe, you know, Tim is just waiting for the right moment to deploy his one or maybe his two Vises, and then you have to take six damage on your next turn. Now, again, the cool thing about land techs is if you're behind on lands, you may search for up to three basic lands. You may also just shuffle your library. You may also just do nothing. So land techs is not a must, you know, it offers you the possibility, making the card even better, right? Because you have the possibility to think, you know what, there's a Vise on the side of Tim, I'm just going to shuffle up a little bit, maybe I need one card to cast something from my hand, you know, one basic land, I'm going to look that up, but I don't need three, you know, I'm not going to hurt myself. So it's really good. When we're looking at the creatures, by the way, I think the Erhnam could be kind of a problem for Roman, in the sense that, you know, he's got 4/4 flyers. The Erhnam with that 5 toughness makes it kind of difficult to deal with. But the good news here for Roman, of course, is that he's playing with 4 Swords main and with 2 Terrors. I think the Terrors are going to be really good. And I also think that he's probably going to board in his other Terror after game 1, you know, because the Terrors, he can hit every creature in the deck of Tim. So it makes it quite good. I also love the inclusion of that one Royal Assassin. You know, Royal Assassin, it's one of those creatures that as a kid, when you're young, you know, when you bought a pack of Revised or Fourth, you were hoping for creatures like Royal Assassin. They were infamous, you know. If you had a Royal on board, it was like you've already won the game. The card was considered to be so strong. Of course, with the knowledge we have now, it's just a 1/1 creature. You can kill it, but back then, it had this status, you know, so I love seeing Roman playing with that single Royal. Okay, we've seen the deck and discussed the deck of Roman. We've discussed the deck of Tim. That means we're ready. Let's go to the first top 16 match of the Reprint Masters. Game number one, here we go. So we've got Roman with the black and white deck, and he's taking a mulligan here, putting a card on the bottom. And then we've got Tim with his Arabian Atog deck, so it's primarily green and red, but there are also blue cards in there and some black cards. Look at the opening by Roman. This is what he wants to do. Land tech turn one. So 4 cards in hand for Roman. Let's see what Tim can do. I guess what he wants to do is just play a creature turn one, hopefully. Okay, there's a mana vault, a little bit of ramping going. So next turn, possibly you could play an Erhnam, for example. That would be pretty big. Roman perhaps tempted now to do nothing, to just pass a turn, but with that mana vault, there we go, stripping away the Bayou. An option for him could have been to also strip away his own scrub land to activate his land tax next turn, but that would have been super risky. So I get this play. Let's see if Tim can find another land. And it's always good, of course, to strip a dual land, because then you cut off 2 colors. And remember, Tim is playing with 2 black cards only, the Demonic Tutor and the Mind Twist. It's a splash you see often. So it looks like the player's a little bit in the tank here. There's a tropical island, and there we see the Erhnam Djinn, 4/5 powerhouse. So that is a pretty big deal. And Roman now putting a paralyze on it. This is a great answer by Roman, because of course Tim used the Mana Vault to cast that Erhnam, so Paralyze here is the perfect answer, because Tim just doesn't have the mana, and now he also deals damage to himself, of course, because the Mana Vault is tapped. So this is a little bit of a problem, and look at that, Roman didn't play out a land, so he's kind of inviting Tim, saying, okay, Tim, if you want to get out of this hellhole, exactly, you got to play more cards, in this case, another land into an Atog. So that means Roman now has an active land tax, looks up three basics, there we go. I wonder now if Tim perhaps is going to play out a Vise next turn. That would be kind of funny. So three cards here drawn by Roman. So he's going to go up to, I believe, seven in hand now. And now he's going to play a Swamp for turn. Could play out a Black Knight, for example, 2-2 first striker. So seven cards in hand for Roman and a pass. Tim, of course, taking a damage. Or is he going to eat up that Mana Vault? That is the question. Could, of course, exactly eat it up and deal 3 points of damage to Roman. So let's see what Tim's going to do attacking here. Are we going to see a Terror? There's the Terror taking care of the Atog. This is what I talked about in the deck tech section, that Roman has a lot of answers to the creature threats of Tim. Pro sideboard, but after sideboarding, he'll even add more removal to the deck. Probably Tim or Roman playing with four Swords to Plowshares main and two Terrors. Let's see if Tim can put some more pressure on the board. I mean, his deck doesn't need a lot of mana, so maybe he doesn't even need to play extra lands now. He's got access to Argovian Pixies, Kird Apes, Ankh of Mishra. It might be interesting for him as well. And of course, a Vise to kind of pressure Roman to play out lands. There's a Forest. Okay, so he is playing out another card, a Kird Ape and an Argovian Pixie. So he's going really for that aggro strategy, allowing Roman to activate his Lantex one more time. But next turn, Tim can possibly attack for four. Remember, both players are still... Well, actually, Tim's on 19 after taking damage from his Vault, but Roman is still on 20. And Roman here is showing his basics. Going to put them in hand. There is another Swamp. Are we going to see an Hypnotic Specter, for example? There's the Hippie, 2-2 Flyer, and when it deals damage to its opponent, the opponent has to discard a card at random, and especially that at random part makes it such a good card. And that Erhnam still being tapped down by the Paralyze. The Paralyze doing a lot of work here. I'm expecting Tim to just attack here with both creatures first before playing anything out. Probably going to wait till second main. Let's see what Tim's going to do. I cannot imagine him passing here. That would be ludicrous. Perhaps a Bolt on the Hippie. He could be considering that. Bolting the Hippie and then attacking for four. I think even if I had a Bolt, I would just attack first and see what he does. So Roman just taking the 4 points of damage. Going to drop to 16. If I have a Bolt, I would actually play it main now because Roman has stepped out. There we see another land being played by Tim. Interesting, a Mind Twist. Okay, Mind Twist for three. Tim, of course, has to take a damage for that city, so he's going to drop to 18, but he's going to take out three cards. And it looks like they're rolling the dice. So he's going to lose a Hippie, and he's going to lose a Serra. Those are good cards because they're not basic lands. You would expect him to just hit a lot of basics, but he doesn't. So this is pretty good. Especially that Serra Angel could have been a problem for Tim. And again, Roman now being able to activate the tax. The tax is doing quite a lot for him. And remember, the Hypnotic Specter is still around on Roman's side of the board. So Tim is definitely going to lose a card here. I believe he only has one card in hand. Perhaps those are two, but it looks like just one card in hand for Roman. Sorry, for Tim. Roman, of course, having a lot more after all those attacks activations. But that was a good Mind Twist by Tim, you know, taking care of the second Hypnotic, taking care of the Serra Angel. I think that was a good move. So Tim, a little bit in the tank here. What is he going to do? I guess attacking is kind of a no-brainer, right? I mean, you're still on 16, you can take a hit of 4. Then again, next turn, Tim can untap his Erhnam for an extra 4 points. I do like the combination of Hypnotic Specter and Paralyze here. There's an anime debt. Ooh, that is really good news for Roman. A 3-4 flyer can block both attackers for Tim, the Kird Ape and the Argovian. There's an attack. He's going to lose that one card that's a Shatter. That doesn't really hurt Tim much. So again, it makes sense that he chose to play out that Mind Twist. And now Tim has a choice to make. Is he going to untap the Erhnam? And this is why Paralyze is so good. You got to make the decision in your upkeep before your draw step. So it's really tough. I mean, if Tim would know what he's going to draw, if it's a Bolt, he would definitely want to keep his mana untapped. But if not, he probably prefers to untap the Erhnam. So Tim really in the tank here. What is he going to do? Because if he chooses to untap the Erhnam, then basically he's going to lose the card he's going to draw into because he needs all the mana. Unless, of course, it's a land. He can just play the land. But if it's anything else, you can see there Tim tapping the finger, thinking, what am I going to do? And he is going to do it, taking a damage, of course, from his own city, going to 16. I understand this decision. I do. You want to keep pressure on Roman's life total. It's tough, though. So there we see, of course, the attack. Well, is he going to attack? I assume so. I mean, you cannot block the flyers anyway. Exactly. There's the attack with the 4-5. Roman probably going to take the damage. Going to drop here to 12. No attacks, by the way, with the Kird Ape and the Argovian Pixies. Could have been a decision as well by Tim. So Roman now on 12. Tim is on 16. But, of course, Tim can deal 5 points of damage now. Then... Or Roman could deal 5 points of damage, I mean, through the air. And Tim will then also lose his card. So things are really looking up here. Roman going 40 attack. So he's going to take the damage, losing the Atog. Is he going to play something out second main? That's a question. I guess he is. Are we going to see a Serra, another Serra Angel by Roman? This is really bad news for Tim. He has to start finding some answers. I think he's going to keep it on tap now, right? Hoping for something. I mean, if he attacks, Roman can double block on both of his Serras, kill the Erhnam, or just take the damage and next turn attack for 9. Which would be brutal. Tim, of course, being on 14 at the moment, so he would drop to 6. Sorry, to 5. Math is difficult. Looks like he is going to untap. He is untapping, going to drop to 13. Wow. This is interesting. I wonder what he's going to do. I mean, if you untap the Erhnam, you want to attack with it, right? Okay, changing his mind, though. Keeping the Erhnam tapped. I mean, if he could find, for example, a Serendib Efreet, a 3-4 flyer, that would actually be quite nice because it can stop one of the angels. And this is unfortunate for Tim, right? Deciding not to untap. And then, of course, when you do that, then you draw into a land. Again, this is what makes Paralyze so good is that as an opponent, you have to make that decision before you know what you're going to draw. This is a horrible situation here for Tim. I think Rome is just going to attack, I assume, with everything, right? Exactly. Dealing 9 points of damage. Tim's on 5. To make matters even worse, there's a trike. This is over, if it wasn't already over. There's not a card in the deck of Tim that I can think of that can kind of save him out of this situation. I mean, he's going to draw anyway. Let's see what it is, but that's it. Exactly. Roman winning here, game number one. And oh man, that Paralyze? That did some work. That Hypnotic Specter did some work. And of course, that text did some work. And when so many cards in your deck are doing so much work, eventually you're going to win. So this was game one. Both players are going to dive into their sideboards. And we're going to catch back up with them in game number two. Game number two. Here we go. So Roman being one game up, it means Tim on the play. Look at him go here. Starting off well with a Soul Ring turn one. That is good news. Roman, they're starting with a Mishras Factory. Maybe it's nice to note that the Mishras Factory is restricted in the Reprint Masters in the rule set. If you want to know more about the rules, check out the description below for info and, of course, a link to the tournament website. And Tim here, turn two, playing an Erhnam, a 4-5 powerhouse, ultimate pressure. And I wonder if Roman's got a terror here. We're going to find out now, I guess. He's going to attack. There's the terror. He probably boarded in the extra one, playing with three terrors main and a swords. Full playset of them. And I think that removal, I think that's what's going to win Roman eventually the match in this matchup. But we'll just have to wait and see. Timmy are having a very strong turn number three with a Serendib, Efreet, and an Atog hitting the board. So that is really good for him. He can start attacking, dealing some serious damage next turn. Let's see if Roman has some answers. There's a land tax again. But now the text doesn't look as strong because Tim really doesn't have to play out any more lands with that Sol Ring. Already has three basics. Also, his deck doesn't need that much. I wonder if we're going to see Tim's Lightning Bolts now as well. That would be quite handy on the Mishra's Factory if Roman decides to animate. I wonder if Tim's going to attack here with the Atog as well. That's kind of the question. Is he then willing to sack the Sol Ring, or by attacking with the Atog, is he signaling a possible bolt in hand? We'll just have to wait and see what Tim will do in the combat step. Two cards in hand only for Tim. Five cards in hand still for Roman. Tim attacking here just with the Serendib. Are we going to see another terror? Another terror? Wow. Roman is really finding the removal here on the right moments in the game. Because can you imagine if you just don't have that swords or don't have that terror, it means you're going to have your Erhnam damage, your Serendib damage, and it's done very, very quickly. But again, when you're playing with seven of those spells, there's a pretty big chance that you'll have it in your opener hand, at least one. Roman found two terrors so far. Tim, just two cards in hand. Looks like he's going to pass. Let's see what Roman can do. I mean, he could consider to attack here with the factory, because if he loses the factory, it's another way to kind of activate his deck. So that could be an interesting situation. Playing a disenchant here on the Sol Ring, of course, Tim, in response, sacking it to his Atog. And of course, Roman, I think this is a good decision by Roman, because then he's kind of forcing Tim to play out an extra land, and that's what Roman wants. Roman can attack here, of course, with the 1-2 Atog, dealing a point of damage to Roman. He's going to drop to 17. So Tim having three cards in hand at the moment, I believe, and passing the turn. So the attack's not working at the moment. And then it's difficult, right? Because maybe, you know, Roman has a Serra Angel in hand. You don't know, or a Sengir Vampire. He's like, well, am I going to invest some lands, possibly drop, you know, my big 4-4 flyer, or am I just going to wait? He is dropping a land. Interesting. A strip mine. There's an ivory tower, and look at that. He's stripping his own land. Yeah, that's a good decision, I think. Stripping his own swamp means next turn he has an active land tax in combination with ivory tower. He can start tanking life, which is great against these aggro decks. This is a big problem for Tim. And again, Tim is not playing with white, so it's very difficult for him to get rid of the tax. Maybe he's got a Tranquility in there, you know, that could kind of help him out. Of course, a Shatter on the Ivory Tower would be kind of nice, but perhaps he boarded those out after Game 1 because they weren't very useful in Game 1. And is Tim going to attack with the Atog? I mean, Roman, of course, has that untapped Mishra's Factory there. This is really bad for Tim. You know, Tim is the type of deck that wants to put pressure on it, wants to win early game. This Ivory Tower, okay, there we see the Shatter. I think this is really good. The Shatter is very important here. Unfortunately for Roman, he couldn't find, for example, an Ankh of Mishra there or a Vise. That would be great follow-up plays as well, but it's just a Shatter. At least he got rid of the Ivory Tower. Because that would, you know, if Roman gets his life gain engine going, that would be disastrous for Tim. And remember, Roman already being a game up, so the pressure's real for Tim here. This is a top 16 match. Both players eager to go to the quarterfinals, of course, of the Reprint Masters, the second edition. With over 50 players competing for the Reprint Master title. There's a basic swamp hitting the board. It's looking, you know, the text is looking really good for Roman right now, because even with that land drop, he's still behind on land, so next turn he gets another activation. And what I love about text is if you take the three cards out of your deck, there's a bigger chance that you're going to, you know, draw into that fat creature that you want, that Serra Angel or Sengir. Or maybe you're demonic, or, you know, the twist. Let's see what Tim can do with his turn. Roman just passing. Three cards in hand here for Tim. Tapping. Okay, there's a Vise. This is good. Vise against Dex. That's really good. What would be ideal at this point for Tim is if he also would have had like a bolt in hand. He could just attack with the Atog, wait for Roman to activate, and then bolt the factory. So here we see some damage for Roman from the Vise. 2 points of damage, dropping to 15. He's not going to activate the tax, not going to use it. Oh, he is. Okay. Look at that. He's not afraid to take some hits. I wonder if he has a disenchant in hand. Then again, if he had a disenchant, he could have played out already. So probably he doesn't have a disenchant in hand. He's going to go up to 9 cards plus draw for turn. Then he has 10 cards in hand. Wow. I really wonder what we're going to see from Roman right now. Because he's got to have a plan with all those cards. I mean, he probably starts with a land drop. I'm expecting him to at least have a land and, I don't know, a Hypnotic Specter or something. Remember, he needs 5 mana to play out his 4-4 flyers. He's not there yet. He's really in the tank at the moment, playing a Plains here. Tapping 4. Okay, taking a damage. Dropping to 14. Ooh, an Armageddon. Interesting decision. Taking care of all the lands. And remember, he already had a land drop, so he cannot play out a land. Interesting. Now 7 in hand for Roman. This move surprises me a little bit. I wonder, of course, we don't see Roman's hand. I mean, we know there's a lot of basics in there, but the reason it surprises me is because you destroy your own factory, and of course, it's harder for you to play out your hand. Okay, here we go. He had an ivory tower in hand. That kind of explains it. That ivory tower is a big help for Roman. At least Tim can attack with the Atog and put some pressure and put him on 9. I wonder if Tim has a land here. Remember, Tim is playing with a lot of burn as well. I mean, we haven't seen it, but it's still in the deck. 4 lightning bolts, 2 fireballs. And especially those bolts are looking pretty good right now if you look at the life total of Roman being on 9. And of course, because Roman has that Ivory Tower and Black Vise kind of cross each other out. So Roman's going to stay on a healthy 9, I guess. There's a Demonic Tutor. Okay, things are looking up now. I wonder what Roman's going to look up, though. Interesting. Because do you really, if you don't have removal in hand, do you really want to go look for removal for that Atog? I don't think so. But then, you know, next turn you will have 3 lands probably. Do you want to play potential blocker for the Atog? Hypnotic Specter could be an interesting choice. I'm really curious to see the next turn from Roman, but let's first see what Tim can do. He only has that Volcanic so far. Attacking, of course, putting Roman on 8. Playing Argovian Pixies. Okay, more pressure on the board. Roman now on 8. Hypnotic is not great here either because of that Argovian Pixies. Then Tim is probably going to attack just with the Pixies offering a trade if Roman plays out a Hypnotic. There's a City of Brass on the side of Roman. Just a pass. I mean, wow. This is really good news for Tim. Looks like he wants to do something. He's going to play a Disenchant on the Vise. That's a good move because that means that his Ivory Tower is going to start netting him life. That is what he wants. The problem, of course, for Roman is that he doesn't have an active tax at the moment. He needs to get that land tax active again, get his handful of cards, and gain some life. Attack here for 3 now. Gonna drop to 5, or are we gonna see a Swords? So there's a Swords to Plowshares on the Pixie. So 2 life gained for Tim. And Roman's gonna drop to 6 here. And just a pass, so also no more pressure. This is good news because now Roman's gonna start gaining some life. 5 in hand, gonna gain a life, gonna go up to 7. Oh, 4 in hand. Okay, so no life gain yet for Roman. But things are looking up for Roman here. Does he have an animate perhaps in hand because it was going through the graveyard? Yeah, and there are some good creatures there in the bin of Tim. You know, there's Erhnam, there's Serendib. That animate could be quite good for him. If he has an animate, you know, you could consider... I would probably get the Erhnam. But there's just a swamp and a pass. Next turn, of course, Roman can have 5 mana. He can start playing out a Sengir or a Serra. And I'm still waiting for Tim to play like his Lightning Bolts. I mean, usually when I play against these red decks, as soon as I'm on like 6, I get killed by direct damage. But maybe I just have bad luck against those type of decks. Or I just remember the moments when I get killed by Burn. And, you know, that is a real thing, right? Selective memory. So I'm expecting him to at least attack with the Atog, put Roman on 5. There's a Taiga. Can he do something? Can he play a Kird Ape? It looks like he can, just passing the turn. Roman is really lucky here. Remember, Roman already a game up. So if he wins this one, he's going to continue in the tournament, going to go on to top 8, quarterfinals. There is land number 5, tapping everything out. There's a Sengir Vampire, 4-4 powerhouse, 4-4 flyer. That is a problem for Tim. I really wonder what cards Tim has in hand. If he's going to attack here, he's kind of signaling to Roman that he has a bolt. There's the attack. Is Roman going to block? He is blocking. And okay, there's a Hurricane. And that's it. That's the game. He's going to deal 4 points of damage with the Hurricane. It took me a moment to realize that, but he's going to deal 4 points of damage with that Hurricane, and he's winning game number 2. And I'm actually happy, not because Tim is winning. I think both players have great decks, but because we are going to game number 3. And I love game number 3. So let's get ready for game 3. Game number 3. Here we go. Who's going to win? Is it going to be the Arabian Atog deck by Tim or Vamps and Angels by Roman? The winner is going to continue in this tournament to the quarterfinals of the Reprint Masters, the second edition, who will crown himself the Reprint Master. And if you like this tournament, remember every week I'm bringing a new video all the way up to the finals. So Roman starting here with a Scrubland and a pass. Let's see what Tim can do. Tim playing a Tropical Island into a Vise. That's a good start for Tim. Finally finding that Vise turn 1. That means some damage here. Probably 2 damage, right? Going to drop to 18, exactly 6 in hand. Drawing to card number 7. And that Vise is quite good against Roman, also because of his whole land tax strategy, although we don't see the tax here. Just a swamp and a pass means 2 more damage for Roman next turn. There's a City of Brass by Tim. What is he going to do? His deck is full of creatures, of course. There's a Vault. Okay, Erhnam perhaps? It's risky. I mean, if Roman has another Terror, for example. Just tapping the 1. Oh, he is going to go for it. Oh, there's a Gloom from the sideboard. And that's going to make it very difficult for Roman. And another vice. I'm liking this. The gloom in combination with the vices. This could be super painful for Roman. He's going to take 4 points of damage, drop to 14. And remember, if he wants to cast a disenchant, he's got to pay an extra 3 because of the gloom. That's going to take a while. Roman will be dead before he can cast that. He needs to find a way to ramp up. An Hypnotic Specter for Roman would be ideal right now. He's got to lose some cards in hand. Okay, there's a Mind Twist. That's something. So Tim, you're going to lose 2 cards. And a Sylvan and a Bolt. Okay, so he is playing with Lightning Bolts. I started to doubt myself, especially in game 2. I'm like, where are the Bolts? Anyway, Tim here taking damage from his own Volt. 5 cards in hand for Roman. So actually, you know, that Twist was a really good play. Because it's going to save him 2 points of damage. And he was able to get rid of the Bolt and more importantly of the Sylvan. I think Sylvan could have done a lot of work for Tim. So that Sylvan's now gone. Roman drawing card number 6. He's on 12 at the moment. There we see a Plains, 5 cards in hand still. Unfortunately for Roman, he cannot cast anything. Tim taking damage from his Volt, going to 17. And just passing the turn. Also, no extra pressure from Tim. This surprises me a little. He's playing with 4 Kird Apes. He's playing with Atogs, Argovian Pixies. Maybe he's got Serendibs in hand. He's just waiting for the extra land. Again, that Sylvan would have been ideal for Tim. Really good from Roman that he got rid of it with the Twist. Roman dropping to 10 now, of course, because of the Vises. He's got 5 mana. Is he able to cast, for example, a Sengir Vampire? That would be really good for Roman right now. 5 cards in hand, so playing an extra card now would mean no more damage from the Vise and a big threat on board if that extra card is the Sengir. I don't think it is, because he needs a lot of time. If he would have had a Sengir in hand, it would have been a no-brainer. Hypnotic Specter, a no-brainer. I mean, maybe his hand is full of white cards. Looks like they're looking up some kind of ruling here. But it's clear that Roman's in trouble. He wants to empty his hand. 5 cards in hand. Looks like he's just going to pass, though. That means next turn he's going to drop to 8. Those vices are really doing work in combination with that gloom. Here we see a Volcanic by Tim. Are we going to see a Serendip? No, we're not. Just a pass. So, I mean, yes, Roman's taking a lot of damage, but it could be worse for him. On the other hand, maybe he's got Terrors in hand that now he cannot play out because Tim isn't playing a creature. Tapping 6 mana here, it seems. No untapping again. I mean, he now has enough mana to play out his disenchants if he has it. Okay, there we see an Hypnotic Specter. This is really good news for Roman. Gonna go to 4 cards in hand, passing a turn. That means next turn, no more damage, and potentially he can start attacking the hand of Tim. Let's see if Tim has a Bolt. I mean, Tim hasn't done that much after playing the Gloom and the Vices. Is he just going to pass here? I mean, that would be great news for Roman. Then he can just swing in with the hippie, discard a card, deal 2 damage, take no damage from the vice because he's got 4 in hand. That would be great for Roman. It looks like he is just passing the turn. No, he's not. He's going to do something here. Okay, there's a soul ring. Are we going to see? Oh, a fireball for 2. Ooh, that must be a tough decision to make. I can understand that takes time because you want to preferably play the ball on the life total of Roman because he's already that low. But if you're going to keep it in hand, going to lose it to the hippie. I think this is a good play. But look at that. Another Hypnotic Specter by Roman. Again, that hippie pressure. Is Tim going to untap the Volt? I mean, I think it's better to just take the damage. Keep your mana options open for whatever you're going to draw. Again, it really depends on what you have in hand. So without knowing the hand, it's really hard for me to say. But with the information I have, I would probably take the damage exactly. Going to drop it to 14. The deciding game here. And it's really a nail biter. I mean, Tim had a really good start with the Vices and the Gloom, but after that, there was nothing really coming from his side of the board, and then Roman is now starting to find some creatures, putting some threats on the table. What is Tim going to do now? An Erhnam would be great for Tim, even though I'm sure Roman has some creature removal in hand. Okay, there we see an Erhnam. I'm really expecting a Terror here or Swords. He's untapping, so I guess he didn't have a Terror in hand because he could have played a Terror on end step. 6 mana, so he's got enough mana to play a Swords if he has it in hand. Takes no damage from the Vices, by the way, because he only had 4 cards. I think now he drew up to 5. There's the attack with Hypnotic Specter, so 2 damage. Tim dropping to 12, and he's going to lose a card. He's going to lose another Erhnam. There we see a strip line on the side of Roman. And the big question now is, can Roman take care of the Erhnam? If he can't, he's going to drop to 4 next turn. Hasn't played out a single Terror, or there we see a strip first, strip on the Volcanic. Hasn't played out a single Terror, or okay, taking it back, or Swords to Plowshares this game. I remember that game too, when those Terrors were just so great for Roman. And the fact that Roman needs this much time, I guess, is a good sign for Tim, because probably means that he doesn't have all playing a Spirit Link. Okay, what I wanted to say, it probably means that he doesn't have a Terror, because a Terror of Swords would kind of be a no-brainer in this situation. So he does have that Spirit Link. Interesting. So Spirit Link, remember, you first take the damage, then you gain the life. For example, if Roman's on 4, he dies before he can get the life, because he gets hit for 4 damage, first takes the damage, after that you gain the life. So you have to be alive to get the life, if you know what I mean. Anyway, Tim dropping to 11. Let's see what he can do. There's a Badlands. Can he do something with that last card in hand? I don't think he can. If that would be a Fireball, he could Fireball Roman for 4, attack with the Erhnam and win the game, but it's not passing the turn. Roman on 8, Tim on 11. Attacking here, putting Tim on 9 probably. Tim losing the last card in hand. It was a Tropical Island. There's another Hypnotic Specter. Wow. That is, I believe, Hypnotic Specter number 3 of game number 3. And now Tim is on top decking mode, staring down on 4 points of damage a turn through the areas, taking a damage, of course, from the Volt, drop to 8. I really wonder what that one card is. I mean, Tim is so close, but then again, he's so far. Just a forest. Ay, 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 ay. Just a forest. So he's going to take 4 points of damage, drop to 4. Take a damage from the Volt, drop to 3. I mean, is Roman going to, you know, fight back and actually win this one and win the match, advancing to the quarterfinals of the Reprint Masters 2? That is the question right now. There's the attack for 4. Dropping to 4 points of life. I mean, I think if you're Roman, you want to play a creature out to block the Erhnam just to be sure. It's gonna... Okay, play and animate that. That's gonna do the trick. That's gonna give him the blocker he needs. This is important. What is Tim going to draw? I wonder if he's going to find a Fireball. He doesn't have enough mana. The question for Tim here as well, do I want to untap the Volt? I don't think it matters whether you're on 4 or on 3 with the current board state. Or does it? If he can find a hurricane, would be really good. If he can hurricane for two, wow. Hurricane is, I think, the go-to card here for Tim. Okay, he's going to drop to three. Can he find a hurricane? He's going to keep it a secret. I wonder what he's going to do. It looks like he's going to attack. I think if I would be, yeah, if I'm Roman, I think I would jump here. Also because then you gain 4 life, you go back up to 12. And it's difficult, but yeah, I would do the same. I would jump. Gonna go up to 12. Passing the turn here. Does Tim have a bolt? If he has a bolt, he can take care of one of the hippies and live another turn. But it's looking really, really good for Roman here. There's the attack. 2 Hypnotic Specters. Is this the end of the road for Tim? He's tapping mana though. What are we going to do? There's a Shatter. End of the road. Roman winning here. Advancing to the quarterfinals with his Angels and Vampires deck. Congratulations, Roman. And that was the episode for today. And behind you, you see the winning deck of Roman. Congratulations, Roman. And also congratulations, Tim, for bringing such a fun match to the table. Both of you guys, it was really interesting to watch. It was a true Magic battle. I love these battles. Both of you were so close. And at moments in that game 3 where I thought Tim was going to take it, and then I thought Roman was going to take it, and in the end, it was Roman being victorious, moving on to the quarterfinals. Now, if you want to see more of this tournament, make sure to hit that subscribe button and ring that bell, because then you will be notified every time I put a new video online. And I am going to show videos of this tournament all the way to the finals. So next week you can watch the top 8 match, then the semifinals, and then the final. So 3 more episodes to go. And before you go, I would like to ask you to like, comment, and share this video. All these things are completely free and they really help the channel move forward. So please take a moment, hit that thumbs up button, leave a comment. It really helps and it's really, really appreciated. Another thing you can do is become a patron of the show. And how does that work? Well, it's really easy. Just visit patreon.com/timmytalks or click on the info card that's appearing right now. So that will take you to the Patreon website of Timmy Talks. And there you can support the channel. It already starts with $1 a month. And the cool thing is, if you become a patron, you get access to the Timmy Talks Discord channel. You also get to join into these tournaments if you want to. If you're at a certain tier level, we can even make an episode together. It is all up to you. So I would really appreciate it if you could take a look at patreon.com/timmytalks and see how you can support the channel. And now let's go to the end scroll.
What shall we do with the drunken sailor? What shall we do with the drunken sailor? What shall we do with the drunken sailor?
Somba Kazee!